I think that we're really on a good track now, and I feel really positive about the future, because I think that, you know, the music is music that I'm really happy with. And it's obviously it's going to develop over the next few years, and I think that is what really excites me. Now I know I'm going and where I'm coming from. So here I come. So here I come. I know I'm going and where I'm coming from. So here I come. So here I come.
She was multiracial, she was unapologetic, she blended the masculine and the feminine. She was sort of the ideal template for what the Buffalo movement was about.
The attitude, just the way she stood at Buffalo's dance in itself.
Neneh was the epitome of that whole movement, but it sort of went above ground and transcended to become a global influence.
She had a massive influence just in terms of feminine force and feminine attitude.
Her energy and her voice, it was just so inspiring.
To me, like, the songs are all like stories, but they are about observation that I make being a human in the world. And it's like figuring out what that means, or how I'm trying to do it, or how I would like to be, or who I don't want to be. When did you start documenting the story?
I'd always carried a camera then. From 14 onwards, you had to have it strapped round your neck, under the jacket. I was just used to take photos of my mates and stuff while we were out and about. And then it just carried on,
yeah,
basically, and turned into a movie camera.
I always obviously remember you before we started working together, being around. And then,
well, we used to hook up at the places like the WAG.
Yeah, wasn't it? Dancing our way into the story. I come from a kind of creative background. My mom was an artist, my father, Amadou, was a musician, my stepdad Don was a musician. Our whole house was like run on music, really. I mean, it was just there all the time, whether we were playing records or someone was playing music. But I didn't naturally gravitate to like playing an instrument. Like my brother Eagle Eye was like playing the drums at two, and you know, I didn't really have that. So actually what I shared with like my dad was listening to music and listening to records together more than actually playing. The first female rap record I bought was Sweet Tea, Tanya Windley, with the Harlem Underground Band, and it's just a fierce record. And that was, like, I think, probably what made me want to rap. The gift she gave me was that I started to like sound like myself. So get a touch, huh? Of too much, huh? And you don't stop, you keep it on. And this is tea. I think about a sound that I love. Like, I mean, I love the bass, but I also like, I think, quite melancholic. Like a mixture of pop references or structure mixed in with, like, the contemporary blues. What's that whisper in your blood? Being around the kind of the Slits family, or with Rip Reagan Panic, or working with you and working with Judy and working with Cam. Cam and I were kind of like, I'd say, spiritually married. In fact, we kind of got emotionally and spiritually married in Fat Tony's DJ box in the White Club. And it was the first time I'd ever taken an E in the DJ box, like telling each other how much we loved each other. And then, like, should we get married? But it was, yeah, like, yeah, well, yeah. Sean had died, you know, Ray died. We were like, we need to get everyone together and like have a posse family gathering.
Honey Dijon speaking.
For me, the whole Buffalo thing was about the things that are really relevant in our culture today, whereas talking about racial diversity in fashion, the hybridity of sportswear with luxury goods, high street fashion. She was multiracial. She was unapologetic. She blended the masculine and the feminine. She was sort of the ideal template for what the Buffalo movement was about. From stylists to singers to rappers to talented producers, she was in that London crew that was just still influences the world.
These are the very famous sunglasses of the very famous Jean-Baptiste Mondino.
290 quid for a pair of sunglasses.
Well, Judy has always been a hero of mine, and I was able to meet him when Kim Jones brought him in to work on the Dior collection. And this last collection was inspired by Judy Blame. But there was something about his eye that it was just, it was the same materials, buttons, safety pins, knickknacks, bottle caps, but the way he put it together was so unique to who he was, and so DIY and so punk and infusing club culture and things that people consider to be rubbish and made it into art. The title of the album, Raw Like Sushi, is just speaking to the rawness of the music and the culture and the creativity, and Judy was completely raw. Neneh Cherry know this story, so it must be told about a group of people left in the cold, caught by a plague, slowly they fade from an immune deficiency, you see, caught AIDS.
When Cameron and Jamie did Looking Good Diving, they wanted to flip it up and change it up a bit on the B-side, so that's how we ended up doing Buffalo Stance.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Neneh Cherry, et ma chanson s'appelle Buffalo Stance. Hallo, mein Name ist Neneh Cherry, und hier ist mein neue Lied Buffalo Stance. Konnichiwa, watashi wa Neneh Cherry desu. Shogi.
And if you think about like how it was, I mean, like when we made Raw Like Sushi, or when we were recording Buffalo Stance, and like where all of the songs start in a way, where you just have this little grain and you kind of roll it around and you plant it, and then, you know, you get a tune, and some of the tunes are like, yeah, fine, this is a nice little ditty, and then some of them you just know that it's captured something in the timing and the, you know, in the place where you made it, the people that you were with, that it's captured something that's kind of timeless. And I think, you know, Buffalo Stance was definitely one of those tunes.
Zadie Smith speaking.
The whole country watched Top of the Pops. It was a huge deal. Whatever happened on Top of the Pops in the evening happened in school the next day, you know? I mean, I can't underestimate, at that time, like, my family used to play, like, spot the black person. So, you know, if you were in another part of the flat and somebody came on telly who was even slightly brown, then you would scream to get everybody else in the room, because it was so rare. And she was dressed like a rude girl. She looked like she had just come off the Kilburn High Road, including the pregnancy. And then when she said, you know what I mean, I don't think I'd ever heard anyone say that on telly. I just don't think I'd ever heard it. The next day in school, as far as I remember, that's all that was going on, named Cherry. I think the hybrid nature of her, like Swedish, somehow American, somehow English, somehow Jamaican, was very familiar to the kind of people I knew, and it was exciting. And the attitude, that seems to me to have incredible influence going forward.
Is it safe for you to sort of go up on stage performing in that condition?
Yes, of course. Yeah? It's not an illness. You know what I mean?
Is it your first?
No, it's my second one. My daughter Naima's at home watching.
And here is Neneh Cherry with the brand new song, number 31 in the charts this week. It's called Buffalo Stance.
Yo, London, before you hear me, right, I want to hear you.
Buffalo Stance came out just when we started the tour. So I remember, like, kind of as we were making our way through the country, that you could just see that people were starting to recognize the track, and like you could just feel the kind of surge. I think by the time we got to Glasgow, like people were actually singing along to it. To the Berlin Wall. Do you remember that?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I remember I was pregnant with Tyson, obviously, and I had to get out. I actually pissed on the wall. It was like, she was like, yeah. Did a turn, sat on my bladder. I was like, I've literally got to get out and go for a pee now. And I peed on the wall. I can remember actually at the gig that night telling everyone in the audience, I was like, yeah, it's nice to be in Berlin. I pissed on the wall.
Get out of Strasser. And here's the highest climber for you at 13 Buffalo Stance. It's Neneh Cherry.
Who's that gigolo on the street with his hands in his pockets and his crocodile feet?
Are you ready for this?
I mean, I think the street, that's where I kind of, I have, and I've kind of, I still do, like I learn almost everything from the first album, from Raw Like Sushi, and then obviously Homebrew Man. They've all been social recordings. The tightness of a difficult era creates a kind of desperation, right? Where it's like, you've got to fucking say something. Like I can't control it.
Here is Robyn. I think Neneh talked about these kind of heavy subjects, but, you know, a big leap that she did, and you felt that it was important to her. But she did it in a way that made me feel, at least, that these things were, like, totally natural to talk about. There was no shame in it. There's, like, a musicality. It's not just about her feminism and about being a strong woman and all of that. Beyond that, she's also this light, like this really strong voice that just hits me. She was queer from the beginning, like there was this open queerness, not saying like in terms of her sexuality, but like as in terms of like she was so open of like how she was mixing references. You know, I could just sense from the beginning she said, you know, I'm with a community that's outside of cultural boundaries in a way.
You know, that feeling of those kind of so-called restrictions can be quite good because you fight against them, and I think in a way that's what we've done a lot in our lives. As a woman and as an artist and as a performer, that I've definitely been completely provoked by those things and wanted to break through them.
Yeah, kick back.
You know, to kick back. Yeah. It's just like, I want to battle with the norm of whatever the norm is, you know?
Yeah.
Creativity is also like a living dialogue, isn't it? Yeah. It's a way of saying the things that we carry around with us. We have to do it for our sanity and sometimes like really overstep the boundaries, you know, because I feel compelled to do that in the world that we're in. You know, losing my mother, which was like so profound. I mean, it was absolutely one of the worst things that's happened, but it was also had a profound effect on me and life. And when I, after a certain, I don't know how many years, like 4 or 5 years, the only thing I could do to really come back to myself, to continue to kind of live in a way, was through the creative thing. I'm the kind of woman that was built to last. They tried erasing me. They couldn't wipe out my past. To save my child, I'd rather go hungry. I got all of Ethiopia inside of me. You know, I can feel like all these things that have been quite fragmented that are coming together. And I can actually hold them and look at them now and feel motivated and inspired by them. And that's the journey. You know, the work that we've done together, like the work that I did with Judy, the work that I'm doing with Cameron, the different people that are part of our body of family, it's a privilege.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And it is, it's like, and it's, it is an interesting thing to have all of that as a kind of, obviously a motivator and an inspirator, but also like as a, it's a history.
That's a message for everyone, isn't it? You can do it.
You can do it.
And I whatever think, it is yeah. you want to do, do it. Don't wish yeah. that you were doing it. Just go for it.
Just go and do it.
Yeah.
I think the thing that's got me through in life is having the strength to get up in the morning. You know, and being positive enough to realize that this is only the beginning of, you know, a world of good things. Like here, I mean, I'm having a certain amount of success, but that isn't everything. You know, at the end of the day, that isn't the thing that stimulates me. You know, the thing that stimulates me is being inspired and being feeling that I'm working on something that is my life. You know, and I think it's important to have something in your life that's worth dying for, you know.